Hi everybody, what I want to talk about today is the question of whether or not we are truly omnivorous as a species. Now every species has their own species specific diet, and we are told almost from the get-go, like it's just indoctrinated into us, there's no questioning it, that we are an omnivorous species, that we can eat anything. We can eat animal flesh and animal secretions and plants and fruits and mushrooms and whatever else there is out there to eat. And truly, if you look around, that's what people are doing all over the globe. And for many, many generations and decades and centuries, people have been eating pretty much everything that is in any way edible. And that's a lot of stuff. So we're more omnivorous practically than any other species on the planet, because we are far wider range of foods than any other species does. But the question still remains, is that who we truly are as a species? Are we truly a species which is omnivorous, designed to eat everything that can be eaten? And that's what I want to question, because I honestly do not believe that that is true. Obviously it's true that we can get by eating a wide range of different foods, but I don't think that is what is best for us, and I don't think that is who we truly are as a species. And I want to highlight some things to make it more clear why I don't think this way. Firstly, I want to compare us to other omnivorous species that are mammal like ourselves. And if you look at other mammal omnivorous species, they have far more in common with carnivorous species than they do with herbivorous species. This is a fact that can't be denied. If you look at any omnivorous mammal species, they have very, very sharp teeth and jaws which can clamp onto the hide of an animal and bite into it in a way that our silly little teeth haven't got a chance of doing. Their jaws are much, much more powerful than the jaws of a human. The other thing that most of them have, omnivorous species, is that they have claws. Claws which are designed for ripping into the side of an animal, for ripping in and getting into the inside of an animal. Now, for most humans, I mean, there may be some exceptions out there, but for most humans, the only way you're going to get into an animal to be able to eat the animal's flesh is by using tools. And I think this goes against who we are as a species, in that it's not what we're designed to do. We don't come equipped with the appendages naturally to do that kind of thing. If you go a little bit lower down into the stomach acids of the omnivorous species are perfectly capable of digesting fur and bones and teeth, the hide of an animal, anything that's kind of in the animal, they can swallow it and they can digest it. So the pH of their stomach acids is very clearly a lot more acidic than that of humans, which is another indication that we are not the same kind of species as other omnivorous species out there. Also, the intestines of such animals are comparatively short to human intestines, which are quite long and puckered and convoluted. So anatomically, we look very, very different internally to any other omnivorous species on the planet. Omnivorous species have a short intestine, and that's because it helps them in expelling things from the body which shouldn't be there. So if, for example, there's things that were in the stomach that didn't get digested properly, they will, with ease, be pushed through the intestinal tract, and they won't get stuck in there. They won't, like, fester in there. With a human, if we eat something which is difficult to digest, and once it gets into the intestinal tract, and it has to go this long, convoluted way before it can actually be expelled from the body, what happens is that bits and pieces will get caught in the pockets and folds of the intestines and can sit there and putrefy there for not just hours or days, but sometimes even for years. There can be things that build up on that intestinal lining, causing a plaque buildup along the lining, which ultimately results in the intestines themselves becoming smaller inside because the walls are moving inwards with that buildup of mucus and food residue, which basically shouldn't be there. So the hole that it has to get through is smaller, which makes it more difficult to eliminate things as well. And eventually, when things sit in there for long enough, we end up with things like bowel cancer. Now, this is something which is basically unheard of in the omnivorous wild animal kingdom. They don't get bowel cancer because their intestines can flush out things that are bigger that don't get digested properly. So this also sets us apart. There's a lot of other things. If you start to look at the physiology and the anatomy of animals, you will see that there is a huge difference between us as a species and other truly omnivorous species that are out there on the planet. And these things all indicate that we are not physiologically, anatomically omnivores. So what are we if we're not omnivorous? And we're clearly not carnivorous, that's out of the question. And we're not herbivorous either, because we don't have stomachs like a cow. We can't chew on cud. Eating grass doesn't appeal to us. So the other category which is left is the frugivorous species. Now, frugivores are designed by nature, by creation, by however you want to think that we are designed. We're designed to be eating a diet consisting predominantly of fruits, and this is who we truly are. And once one starts doing this, eating a diet which is predominantly or solely consisting of fruits, you'll find that the body will start to cleanse so much, because when you're eating a standard omnivorous diet, especially if it's cooked and you've got grains in there as well, your body will be carrying so many things that it shouldn't be. So switching to a frugivorous diet, you'll be doing yourself a huge favor. Now, I just want to add two other things, actually, to kind of really drive home the fact that we are not omnivorous as a species. And those are, let me give you a couple of little thought experiments. If you're out for a walk in nature, you're walking along some forest track, and you haven't had breakfast yet, you're feeling hungry, and on the path in front of you, you see a dead squirrel, or a wombat, or a possum, or a badger, or whatever it might be, you see a dead animal on the path. Now, flies are buzzing around it, and it's got quite a strong smell. Omnivorous animals, truly omnivorous animals, will not hesitate, if they're hungry, to go straight at that cadaver, sniff around on it, and bite into it, and eat if they can. It's opportunistic food. It didn't have to spend energy killing the animal. The animal is lying there on the path. They're not going to hesitate, because that's free food for them. My point is, every truly omnivorous animal, the instinct of that animal when they're hungry will be to go in and eat from that cadaver. Whereas for us, we will find it unappealing. We will find it rather disgusting. We will not like the smell of it. Rotting cadavers do not smell good to us. That's another thing that omnivorous animals and we don't have in common. We do not like the smell of rotting cadaver. And our sense of smell actually is another thing which distinguishes us from the truly omnivorous animals, because they have a far, far keener sense of smell than we do. Pretty much all of them. If there's a dead rat in the attic, and you go up there, you might smell that rat. He's hidden behind some boxes somewhere, but you won't know where he is. You could search around thinking, where is he? But if you bring a dog in there, that dog will soon sniff the dead rat out, because the dog is an omnivore. I mean, he's maybe more carnivore, I suppose. But in this sense, omnivores and carnivores are very similar. So that's what a true omnivore would do. He would very quickly find that rat. Anyway, the second and final thought experiment I want to leave you with is, imagine that you are once more taking a nice countryside walk. It's a beautiful day, and you see there is an animal caught in the barbed wire fence that's very close to the path that you're on. Clearly, the animal is in distress. The animal is struggling to get free, but he or she can't because he's caught up in the barbed wire. Or it can be netting or whatever it might be, he's caught up in something. Now, what would be the instinct of an omnivore? I mean, a true omnivore. What would be the instinct of the omnivore? Once more, free food. Opportunity is there. A truly omnivorous animal wouldn't hesitate. He would catch and eat that animal that's caught up in whatever it is that he or she is caught up in. We, on the other hand, we have a heart. Our natural instinct, when we see an animal suffering in some way, suffering in this kind of way where he's caught up in a trap that he cannot get himself loose from, our natural instinct is to go in and free that animal. We want to do that. It makes us feel good. It makes us feel like, oh, I'm a good person because I did a good deed. I helped rescue that poor bird or that poor squirrel that was caught up in something, some kind of trap, or just accidentally caught into something. We will feel good. Our hearts will feel good. This is because this is who we truly are as a species. We are not the species that's going to be looking at a pigeon and wanting to straight away grab that pigeon and thinking about, oh, I'm going to take that pigeon home and put him in my oven. Or a true omnivore would not even do that. He would just catch the pigeon if he could and bite into him straight away, because why wait? And cooking is something which makes these kind of foods that we shouldn't be eating in some way more digestible for us. If it wasn't for the cooking process, most people would be turned off by eating cow and pig flesh. And most people, if they fully could understand the truth of what happens in the animal agricultural industry, they would be profoundly disturbed. They would be so deeply affected that it would make them think, and for many people, maybe make them turn vegan or vegetarian until they know the full truth about the dairy and egg industry too. And of course, there are people that would want to deny anything because they don't want to know. They really don't want to know. There are people that are kind of, they don't want to change. They don't want to know the truth. They just want to carry on eating because they think, bacon, because that's the kind of mindset that they're at the moment, where they don't recognize animals for who they truly are. All it is for them is animal or animal secretion. And of course they say meat and dairy or eggs or whatever, but the truth is we're talking about animal flesh and animal secretion, and they don't want to see it for what it really is. They want to see it as meat and dairy and eggs, and that has been a valid food source for us because we are anatomically omnivorous, which is a lie. So I hope that I can have some agreement here that we are not that kind of species that would be going out and killing animals left to our own devices. Most of us wouldn't really have a clue how to kill an animal, and most of us would feel incredibly hurt just at witnessing the act. Hurt. I think that's a very true word. Once we witness it, unless we've been fully desensitized because we've grown up in that environment where we witness it on a daily basis, unless we're in that kind of environment, the rest of us who aren't will find it very, very distressing to see an animal being slaughtered, to see the bleating lamb as she tries to struggle away from the knife, which is inevitably going to take her life. So please, please realize that we are not omnivorous, and we are truly a frugivorous species because, look, we've got nails. They're perfect for peeling oranges. Anyway, take care, all of you. See you next time.